Fourth chapter. Book of 2 Timothy, 4th chapter, verse 1. Okay. Read down to verse number 2. In the name of the Lord. 2 Timothy 2, 4, verse 1 and 2. The word of the Lord says, I charge thee therefore, for God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead, and the spirit, and his kingdom. Just preach the word, be instant in season and out of season. Preach the word, be instant in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long suffering and doctrine.
Amen.
So the time will come. And they will not endure sound doctrine.
Amen.
But after their own lust shall they keep to themselves teachers having itching ears. And they shall turn away their ear from the truth, and shall turn in to fables.
Lord have mercy.
Verse number 2 and 3 again, to preach the word, be instant in season and out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long suffering and doctrine. The time will come, and they will not endure sound doctrine. But after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears.
Jesus.
And tonight, just briefly, I want to talk about the missing ingredient, which is rebuke.
Amen.
Missing ingredient, which is rebuke. Many times in the church, we love to be encouraged, and we love to hear words and messages that will cause us to shout, dance, and to rejoice.
Amen.
But oftentimes we never want to be rebuked.
My Lord.
So I want to just deal with the scriptures tonight. I just want to deal with the scriptures tonight. I'm dealing with this missing ingredient.
Amen.
The apostle here encourages this Timothy, who he's writing to. He actually encourages him and admonishes him to do this very thing. He says, preach the word, be instant in season and out of season. And he tells him to reprove and to rebuke, to exhort with all long suffering and doctrine. In defining what rebuke is, let's find out what the biblical understanding of rebuke is. The definition of rebuke simply means to express sharp disapproval or criticism of someone because of their behavior or actions. To express sharp disapproval or criticism of someone because of their behavior or actions. Another word comes up is the word admonish. The word admonishes means to warn or reprimand someone firmly.
Amen.
All right, I want y'all to pay attention to these definitions real good.
Okay.
To express sharp disapproval or criticism of someone because of their behavior or actions. Admonish, to warn or reprimand someone firmly. So oftentimes we have to see through the word of God when the apostles repeat themselves multiple times. It normally lets us know that it is important what they're trying to convey or what they're trying to teach. And so the apostle Paul will write to Timothy and will tell Timothy that one of his priorities as a leader in the church of the Lord Jesus Christ is to rebuke.
Amen.
But look what he also was going to tell Titus in Titus 2. In Titus, the second chapter, verse number 11.
Mm-hmm.
Titus 2, verse number 11. He says, "For the grace of God that bringeth salvation has appeared to all men, teaching us that denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world, looking for the blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity, and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works."
Amen.
"These things speak and exhort and rebuke with all authority, that no man despise thee."
Amen.
The Apostle Paul goes from writing to Timothy to tell Timothy that he must be able to rebuke. Now he goes and tell Titus the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
He tells Titus that you got to do these things, speak them and exhort and rebuke, but he adds with all authority.
Amen.
Now remember, rebuke means to express sharp disapproval or criticism of someone because of their behavior or actions.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
And it means that somebody's doing something that the men of God are not approving of, and they must be rebuked for it. Now quiet it.
Amen. Amen.
He said you must be rebuked for it with all authority. And many people have shied away from the word rebuke because it seems to be negative. The word of God never speaks of rebuke in a negative light.
Amen. Amen.
The scriptures never deals with rebuke in a negative manner.
Amen.
Only rebels and individuals that are rebellious
Amen.
Will call rebuke evil, or
Amen.
Call
Amen.
Rebuke unloving, or they'll call rebuke
Amen.
Something that they feel should not be done by preachers.
Mm-hmm.
Only rebellious people.
Amen. Amen.
Who are unlearned and unskilled in the word of truth.
That's right.
Refuse rebuke in that manner.
Amen.
But let's see what the word of God says about rebuke.
Thank you, Jesus.
Let's go to the book of wisdom, the book of Proverbs,
mm-hmm.
the 9th chapter.
Amen.
The book of Proverbs is going to teach us tonight and give us a perspective of what rebuke should feel like and how it should be viewed for a believer.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Proverbs 9 and verse number 8. And remember, the writer of these Proverbs is one of the wisest men that is of his day. So, you know, if somebody wise is telling you something, it pays for you to
That's
listen.
That's right. Amen. Amen.
Yeah. So Proverbs 9, verse number 8, begins and says, "Reprove not a scorner, lest he hate thee." But then he says, "Rebuke a wise man,
and he will love
you."
Amen. Amen.
Praise the name of the Lord.
Amen.
"Rebuke a wise man, and he will love you."
Amen.
"Give instruction to a wise man, and he will be yet wiser."
Amen.
"Teach a just man, and he will increase in learning."
Amen.
"The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom."
Mm-hmm.
"The knowledge of the holy is understanding."
Amen.
Reprove, scorner, A scorner will view you as evil.
Jesus.
Or wicked.
Right.
And he will view you as one whom he hated. Now let's just jump to Amos 5 and 10 to prove how people view those that rebuke. Amos 5, verse number 10. Brother Jeffrey, help me.
Yeah.
The word says what? Amos 5, verse 10.
They hate him.
They hate him.
That rebuketh in the gate.
My God.
And they abhor him.
Individuals that will correct or reprimand individuals for their behavior ends up becoming hated.
It's true. Amen.
Because the reality is, people do not like to be told about
what
themselves.
To do. You're right. Amen.
So when you tell them about themselves, when you express sharp disapproval or criticism of someone because of their behavior or actions, then there is hatred that begins to spring forth.
Amen.
Only in an unwise individual.
Amen. According to the word.
That's the key. In
That's
an
right.
unwise individual.
Amen.
But in a wise man, he would love you more.
Mm-hmm.
Because rebuke will cause him to know what not to do the next time.
Amen. Make it in.
And so what he'll do is, he'll learn from his mistake.
Thank you, Jesus.
He'll grow from his mistake.
Amen.
And he'll develop.
Yep.
And he'll become a better him.
Amen.
So the fool, when they hear rebuke, the only thing that they hear is the criticism.
Yep.
And they don't hear
That's
the growth
right.
in it.
Amen. Amen.
They hear the development in it.
Thank you, Lord.
They only hear the negative.
Negative. That's right.
That's why many people in church have stepped away from rebuking individuals for things that is not correct when it comes to the word of God.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
And so now you have people in the house of the Lord doing whatever they want to do.
Jesus.
Acting however they want to act.
Mm-hmm.
In the house of God.
Amen.
And the church has now become a place of lawlessness.
Amen.
There are no guidelines.
Amen.
There are no rules, and there are no regulations.
Amen.
And then when individuals begin to correct individuals, then all of a sudden, people begin to have attitude.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
And they begin to talk against the ministry.
Amen.
They talk against the church, and they talk against the preacher.
Amen.
Because they had to correct them.
Jesus.
I've never seen so many people that claim today to be sheep of God, but walk around shepherdless.
Wow. Amen.
Amen.
That's
walk
true.
Around shepherdless.
That's true.
They walk around with nobody that will hold them accountable, neither will anybody reprimand them. The biggest cause for individuals to leave a church or a ministry is not because of sin. It's not because of disagreements. It's not because somebody's stealing money. It's not over doctrine. The biggest reason people leave ministries is because they got rebuked.
Amen.
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 That's
right.
They would like to make it believe that I left because of this and I
right.
left because
right.
of that.
Amen.
Oh, I left because you were preaching this. I left because they were doing that. I left because they did that. No, that's an excuse.
Yeah.
The underlying reason why you probably left the church was because somebody told you about
yourself. About yourself. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You want to do what you
want to
do.
You just did not want to admit it.
That's right. Amen.
But you got an attitude and you stormed out of the church.
Amen. That's the truth.
9.9% of the people that leave ministries is because they got rebuked.
Amen.
And instead of humbling themselves and repenting.
That's right.
See,
the enemy.
Yes.
Really help don't want this
Please help. Jesus. Help them out. That's right.
But people don't want to be rebuked.
Yeah.
That's right.
See, but God is going to give us an outline in his word
yes.
of how we should view rebuke.
Yes, yes.
Proverbs 28. And then I'm going to show you, after I'm done here, I'm going to show you who rebuke includes and who it does not exclude.
Amen.
All right, y'all have been with me. Because I know there's a lot of people that are probably real happy at this message. Uh-huh. You know, but turn and my days will come down.
Down their street, right? That's right. Yeah. Come
Proverbs
on, Pastor.
Proverbs 28 and verse number 23. Proverbs 28.
Amen.
Verse number 23 says this. It says, he that rebukes a man afterwards shall find more favor.
Hmm.
That he that flattereth with the tongue.
Amen.
Amen. So I'll read it again to help some people. He that rebuketh a man afterwards finds more favor than he that flattereth with the tongue.
Amen.
It's easy to tell people you did good.
That's right.
It's easy to tell people and to flatter people and to stroke people's egos. To make them feel like they're something when they're nothing, it's easy to do that.
Amen.
But in the long run, not only do you damage them, but you damage yourself.
That's right.
Because now you're not truly a good friend if you allow somebody to go down a road of negativity and go down a road of error, and you do not correct the error of their way.
Amen. Amen.
So not only do you mess them up, but you mess yourself up.
Mm.
Because the Bible says, he that will rebuke, he that will chastise an individual, correct them for the error of their ways, you're going to find favor.
That's what it said.
If you notice, there are not too many things throughout the Word of God that he connects favor to.
Amen.
So when God connects favor to something, it's best that you grab a hold to that.
Amen.
The Bible says, he that findeth a wife, findeth a good thing, and obtaineth favor
from the Lord.
Of the law.
That's right.
Certain things in the Word of God, God will connect favor to.
Mm-hmm.
Everything is not connected to favor. But one of the things that we end up finding connected to favor is an individual that will rebuke a man.
Amen. Amen.
Afterwards, he shall find more favor than he that flattereth with the words, with the tongue. Right? A wise man will praise an individual that corrects them.
Amen. Amen.
They will be ever grateful to an individual that will correct them.
Mm-hmm.
They will exhort an individual that corrects them. Because a wise person knows that without that correction, they cannot be a better them.
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
So I want y'all to allow the enemy's thoughts that he gives you concerning rebuke to be pushed out of your mind.
Jesus.
And for you to have a biblical perspective of rebuke.
Thank you, Lord.
Now, granted, it doesn't feel good.
No. No.
Because the Bible says no rebuke feels good at the present time.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody feels good being rebuked. That's just the reality of the matter. But in the long run, it's working.
That's right. Yes, it is. Yes, it does.
Ecclesiastes 7, verse number 5. All right? And we just want to let the Bible do a lot of the talking tonight. Because what happens is many times people get into discussions and things and they give a whole bunch of opinion and never give Bible.
Mm.
For nothing that they say.
Right.
Well, anybody that is standing in opposition of the scripture, when you get into a biblical discussion with them, they'll talk, and will never quote one scripture.
Amen.
Amen.
But they'll tell you that this is the way that it's supposed to be, and you ask them, well, where is that in the Bible? They can't give you no scripture.
Give you scripture.
So they do a whole bunch of talking in circles and never will give a biblical answer to support why they're saying what they're saying.
Amen.
Alright?
Amen.
See, but we are people of the Word, and so whenever we make a statement, we want to have power to back up what we're saying.
Amen.
Ecclesiastes 7, verse number 5, it says, it is better to hear the rebuke of the wise than for a man to hear the song of fools.
Amen.
Amen. It is better for a wise man to correct you and to rebuke you than to have the songs of fools playing in your ear.
My Lord.
It's better to have a wise man correct you than to have a bunch of people flattering you
when
you're dead.
Lying to you, yeah?
Just to keep you as a friend.
Yeah.
I'd rather you despise me and I tell you the truth about the matter.
That's right.
Than to have you loving me, smiling in my face, and I know something wrong with you.
Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Love will cause you to correct your brother and sister.
Amen.
And it goes beyond the preacher doing it. If you see your brother and sister in an error, it is your obligation and duty as a brother and a sister to go to them and to say, look, brother, you're wrong.
Amen.
Sister, you are incorrect in the way that you're handling this matter. It's called accountability.
Amen.
Hold one another accountable.
Come on.
You hold them accountable. And accountability and rebuke has easily crept out of the church.
Amen.
Trick of the enemy.
People in the pew telling preachers that they should not get in the pulpit and correct things over the pulpit. How dumb do you sound?
I'm telling you, not reading your word.
How foolish do you sound?
That's right.
And how unbiblical do you sound?
Right. How the church going to
get
clean?
Because when you go back to the book of scripture, you're going to find out that not only it should be done sometimes openly.
That's right. According to the word.
Call it open rebuke.
That's right.
That thing that used to happen in the old church, which we always used to talk about, but now in this new church, it ain't happening.
Right.
Because we're too fearful that if we openly rebuke something, they're going to leave the church.
Yeah.
And when they leave the church, we're going to lose their little tithes and their little offering.
Uh-huh.
And can I tell you something? You can keep your $2 million.
That's right.
I'd rather have people in the house
right.
of God that will take wise counsel and wise rebuke than to have a bunch of money in the house of God and a bunch of hard-headed people.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
So what? You give $1,000. If you give $1,000 and you're rebellious,
right.
you're still not giving nothing.
That's right. Not going to make it.
All you did was just give away a $3,000. But God ain't honored nothing that you gave.
Right.
Because the Bible said obedience is better than sacrifice.
Amen.
So I don't care if you give $1 million in offering, your sacrifice is nothing if it's not connected to obedience.
Amen. Amen.
So any preacher that will allow people to stay in the house of God in rebellion and take their money is doing that individual a disservice.
Amen.
Will end up showing that the heart and the mind of that leader is more about money than the saving of that individual soul.
Amen.
And we got more preachers today that are more concerned about the Almighty dollar.
Yeah.
And I call it Almighty because Almighty has become their God.
Amen. That's right.
Amen.
They're more concerned about the Almighty dollar than the saving of the souls of the people
Jesus.
That God has entrusted them to.
Mm-hmm.
So they're doing them a disservice and they allow them to come in the house of God actively in disobedience.
Yes.
My God.
We'll see them doing something that is contrary to the word of God and will not say anything about it.
Amen.
And many may say, well, I'm not doing it for the money, but maybe you're doing it for membership.
Right. Amen.
I just want to say that all we pack the church up.
Amen.
Every Sunday we get 100 people coming.
Huh?
But what is the point of having 100 goats in the house of God?
Amen. Amen. Amen.
All you got is a bunch of goats.
Jesus.
And you know they're a goat when you tell them to do something and they buck up at it.
Uh-huh.
Everything you tell them to do, they buck up at it.
Uh-huh.
Amen.
You say A, they say B. You say C, they say D. It's always a problem.
Yes.
It's always an issue.
Amen.
It's always what I think. Nobody asks you what you thought.
Right, right, right.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. It's always an opinion.
Always.
Always something. And whatever you say is always contrary to what somebody else does say.
My God.
You know, and all five people say, well, we think it should be done this way, but I think it should be done. Sometimes it ain't about what you just heard all five people say, I thought it should be done this way. Even if you felt like it should have been done, you should say, well, you know what? Let's go with what everybody else is saying.
Right.
So Sometimes you got to compromise. Your Amen. Way ain't always the right way.
No, sir. No, sir.
Your point of view is not always the right view.
That's right.
You just have that person. 20 people can say the same thing, and they just butt.
But.
But what?
That's true.
You got to watch out for contrary people.
Amen.
And the problem is that in the church, we got a bunch of, a lot of time, we got a bunch of contrary people. Under the disguise of Christians, believers, but contrary.
Amen.
Teach something, tell them that you got to do this, they'll say, well, I ain't got to do all that.
Right.
And we'll still come to church in blatant disobedience.
Mm.
I'd rather an individual leave the church and be in rebellion than to keep coming and be in rebellion.
Amen. Amen.
Hey, you just gonna keep coming. You don't believe nothing the church believes.
Right. Amen. That's right.
You know, I always complain. Why they gotta do it? Why we gotta do that? Why you keep coming? That's the question.
Right. Right. Amen.
If you don't agree with the teaching, go find a church.
Right.
Right.
That you agree with the teaching.
Right.
I don't keep coming to a place that I disagree with everything they do. You the bigger fool. You got so much to say about what they're doing, but you keep coming.
Right, right, right. Amen.
Every Sunday you gonna show up and you gonna sit and you gonna shout and you gonna dance, and then when the preacher gonna preach that, you gonna be mad. So what you come for?
What you come? My God.
It makes absolutely no sense. Only a fool would do that.
That's what the Bible says.
Only a fool.
Amen.
But rebuke is essential.
Amen.
Without rebuke, we can never grow and develop to be what God would have us to be.
No, we can't.
If you never know what is wrong and have the ability to correct it, you can never grow.
That's right. Can't make it right.
And that's what the enemy wants. The enemy wants a bunch of dormant saints.
Yes.
Amen.
People that will come into the house of God and there will never be an effective change that takes place in their life.
Jesus.
It is impossible for you to be in the church and truly in the church and be the same way you were 10, 15, 20
That's
years
right.
ago.
That's right. Amen.
It's impossible.
Impossible.
Somewhere along the way, the word of God should have rubbed up against you.
Amen. Uh-huh.
And should have caused you to shred that dead skin. It's no way in the world you've been sitting under the word of God for all these years, but yet walk around with malice and hate and envy and jealousy still in your heart. And then you got the audacity to have it, but then get an attitude when the preacher says something about it.
Right.
Amen.
Lord have mercy.
If you don't got it, you ain't got to preach about it. If it's not transpiring in the church,
right,
then we would not have a reason to ever mention it.
Right.
If you don't want the preacher to preach on it or mention it, stop doing it. It's just as simple as that.
Amen.
Why he got to preach on it? Why he got to talk about that? Because it's in here. As long as it's in here,
That's right. Amen.
That's
right. That's the word.
As long as it's in here, we got to remind you every now and again. You got to get it out of your heart.
Have to.
You can't act like that. You can't talk like that. Jesus. You can't even treat people that way. You have to tell the truth.
Amen.
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 And then when it stops, then he can get off of it.
Right. And move on to the next.
Deal with something else.
Yeah. That's right.
But until it becomes rectified and a change takes place, the preacher must preach on it.
Amen. It's his duty.
Amen.
See, but what we have less rebuke in the house of God, and we got more witchcraft in the house of
Jesus.
God.
Amen.
And witchcraft takes place when there's spiritual manipulation.
Yes.
And now what preachers have found themselves being in a confrontation with is they found themselves in confrontation with people in the pew that's trying to dictate the pulpit.
Jesus. Come on. Come on. That's right. Fix that mic. Get that mic fixed.
With this thing.
Yes.
Yes, it's acting foolish tonight.
Yep. Devil trying to rise up.
But what happens is you got the pew trying to take the pulpit.
Uh-huh.
The pew operates in witchcraft.
Uh-huh.
Where the pew tells the preacher, don't preach that.
Uh-huh.
The only person that controls what the preacher preaches is God.
It's God. Amen.
I thought that's who called the preacher.
Amen. Amen.
If I'm not mistaken, I thought that's who called the preacher.
The preacher.
I thought God called the preacher. And if God called the preacher, then that means that God is going to tell the preacher what to
preach.
What
to say, that's right. Amen. It's his messenger.
One thing that grinds my gears is that people who God did not put in position try to tell the one whom God put in position how to preach, what to preach, and when to preach.
Jesus.
That's witchcraft.
That's witchcraft. That's witchcraft.
It's witchcraft. And you got so many people that go behind closed doors and get on the telephone and will tell the preacher, I don't think you should preach that. Oh, it's not the time for you to preach that.
That's what they say. Yeah, that's what they say.
Who's given you this type of knowledge to tell the preacher when to preach it and when not to preach it? If you had that much sensitivity to the Spirit to know when to do something, God would have made you the preacher.
That's right. Thank you. Amen.
Thank you. Amen.
He would have made you a pastor.
That's right.
I have never seen so many pew pastors in my life.
Oh, my God.
If you want a pastor, go get you a church of a little flock somewhere.
That's right.
Yeah, pew pastors gonna tell you shouldn't preach that and you shouldn't say that. Wow. If it's written in the Bible, there is nothing in this Bible that I can't preach.
Amen. 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 Here a little, there a little.
I want to preach.
That's right.
Folks in the pew that need the Word of God.
That's right.
Are gonna dictate to us when the time is right. Give me Ephesians 4. Ephesians 4. Jump down about verse number 7 or so. And I just want to see the gifts that God put in the church. Because he gave some. He gave some.
Some.
What did it say, brother? Verse number 11.
And he gave some
apostles, and he gave some
prophets,
and some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers
for the perfecting
of the saints. Now, if God then gave us these gifts to perfect you, how can you tell us how or when